Okay, so what can you tell us about the car?
Yeah, I bought it with a partner about 18 years ago, so it was in a not good condition. So we decided to rebuild and restore the car, and we put new paint on it, we welded some stuff, we made the engine, and I made the technical stuff, and he made the bodywork.
Wow.
The real treasure in this car is going to be under that bonnet. Can we have a look?
I'm sure, yeah, sure, sure, sure. Let's do it.
Get in.
Look at that.
Hey.
So it's had a full rebuild?
Yeah, the engine was a full rebuild, new pistons, new gears.
New everything, basically.
Really, yeah.
I mean, how many miles since the rebuild?
5,000 kilometres.
Oh, wow. I'm going to be looking for any signs of potential accident damage. When a car's been fully rebuilt, you've got to ask yourself the question, why was that done? Was it done just to restore the car, or was it done because there was some kind of issue in its history? The interior is lovely, I have to say. Ooh. Oh, apart from that, it's got what looks like a cigarette burn in this beautiful fabric. That tiny bit of damage probably means a whole seat retrim, and I've also uncovered a crime against the most important single letter in performance motoring. Have you spotted the glaring obvious error from this view?
The M3 badge is on the wrong side.
Exactly,
isn't it?
It should be over there.
There's also another thing as well. If you look at that red stripe in the bumper, that's for the Evolution model. It shouldn't be on here.
Details matter, so they're the sort of things we would have to get right. But none of the details matter if this high-mileage E30 doesn't deliver on its reputation as the ultimate driving machine.
Yeah, we're in Germany. They go fast here. Right, we're on a nice bit of road.
Ready?
Yeah, go and plant it. Oh, yeah, 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 yes!
Oh, I still got it,
yeah.
Mate!
Oh, that's got some tug, isn't it, eh?
I tell you what, that feels lovely.
That has got some tug. We're driving in southern Germany a BMW E30 M3, and almost everyone that sees us on the street, look, and we go past, they either say something or wave at us in this car. It's a celebrity. It's not us. The car is a celebrity. Is it me? Are we in top gear there?
Yeah.
Can you hear that?
A little whiny sound.
It's a, well, it's kind of a dull sort of constant noise.
It's not bad. I definitely wouldn't say it's bad, but my experience of driving these before, it feels like it could be a little bit tighter. This car's done 181,000 kilometres.
Correct.
And although the engine's good, 5,000 kilometres old, mate, that is basically brand new, isn't it? And it's the rest of the car that's perhaps my worry, because I think a little bit tired. Right, there's definitely some brake judder.
I could just feel that. Yeah, I was just about to say that.
So that is a worry. So look, it's not without its problems. It looks amazing on the outside. You know, this is a car that just has to be right. So we're going to take a gamble, mate, because this is an awful lot of money.
Don't put me under too much pressure, but let's... Why don't we go back? We've now got some tools, haven't we, to negotiate with Sebastian.
I'm slightly terrified at the amount of money that this costs. Of course, the potential to make quite a lot of money off the back of it is still there, but there's also potential to lose quite a lot.
Somehow, we need to achieve visual perfection and fix the brakes and diff. Squeezing a profit out of this is going to be a tough ask. Well, it drives really, really well. There were a couple of little things I think we found when we were driving it around.
Yeah, one or two little details, and these cars are all about the details, as you well know.
So, with that in mind, you advertised it for 70,000 euros.
Yes.
We've come a long way to come and buy your car, and we were kind of hoping that you would sell us the car for 65,000 euros.
No, I'm sorry, that's too far away.
It's too far away?
Yes. I would do 69,000, but that's the lowest.
69,000 euros.
That's a huge amount of money. But are we really going to walk away from this? Come on.
I can't believe I'm doing this. You got yourself a deal.
Okay.
Well done, Sebastian. Thank you very much.
No serious buyer is going to pay top price for a whiny M3. The E30 M3 was noted for its pretty epic handling, and a large part of that came from this. It's a limited slip differential. I could hear a slight whirring sound coming from down here. It could be a sign that the crown wheel or the pinion might be worn, even both, to the point where if we have to replace them, that's going to get expensive. A new limited slip differential would set us back more than €1,000. Low mileage E30 M3s can fetch six figures, but with 180,000 kilometres on our clock, we need to keep our costs low to stand any chance of a profit. That's heavy. I'm going to strip it down and hope I can find and fix the problem. I'm looking for signs of wear and tear on the teeth of the crown wheel here. Discoloration where it may have overheated. Now what I need to do is to make sure that the pinion gear sitting in the front of the diff here is meshed correctly with the crown wheel. And I've got a little test to do that. I need everything spotless, so I'm using brake cleaner to remove the old oil. Next, I'm applying marking paste to the thrust face of our crown wheel. Once that's dry, I can rotate the diff by hand, which should leave a clear witness mark where the two gears engage. And what I can actually see is a pretty clear picture that the engagement is happening too far towards the outside of the crown wheel teeth. Now, the problem with that is that it's not spreading the load evenly. We're not using the strongest part of the tooth. We should be seeing that witness mark sitting nicely in the centre, but we're not. It's offset. The solution is going to be to take these two caps off the side of our differential, see what kind of shims we've got behind here, and if we can, find the right amount of adjustment to bring that nicely back to a central engagement. I'm going to try new shims that are 0.01 of an inch thicker than the old ones. It's a tiny adjustment, but it could make a huge difference to the performance of our M3. Oh yeah, that is much better. That's exactly what I was looking for. The witness mark is now central on the tooth, which shows it's exactly where we need it to be, and hopefully that's the solution to that annoying little noise. When I drove the car, I noticed a sensation called brake judder. It's when the brake pedal sort of pulses back under your foot under heavy braking, and it can even, at times, warp the disc. The first step for me, though, is to check and find out exactly what it is, and I'm going to use this. It's a DTI gauge, or dial test indicator. When I mount it, positioned accurately against the disc face, I can then rotate it and see if it's still running true or not. Right, I've got my mount magnetically attached to the suspension leg with the gauge positioned up against the face of the brake disc. And as I rotate it, we should see the dial move to show just how out of true this disc is. In other words, if the gauge goes up, our profits go down. Oh dear. There we go, straight past the 20. Oh my goodness, yeah, that went right up to 50 on the gauge and back to zero. So that is half a millimetre out of true as we rotate that through 360 degrees. And unfortunately, that's going to mean I need to replace the front pair of discs at least.
In recent years, dry ice cleaning's been a game changer for restoration work. It's non-abrasive, faster, and more economical than mechanical or chemical cleaning. When you're chasing perfection and the best possible sale price, the entire car needs to look immaculate. The pellets hit the car's mucky underside at supersonic speeds, freezing dirt particles, creating micro cracks, and stripping decades of grime in an instant.
That's better, I might leave it like that.
I'm determined to take every filthy nut and bolt back to their 1980s glory.
Click here to subscribe.